I've ended up choosing PSR B1257 plus 12C, also known as one of the very, very first exoplanets that was ever found orbiting a pulsar.
Have you ever wondered what it's like to discover a brand new world? In the last 3 decades, we've found over 5,000 planets outside our solar system, called exoplanets. I'm Dr. Jessie Christensen, the lead scientist at the NASA Exoplanet Archive. This is Explore Exoplanets, The Discoverers, a series where I interview the brilliant minds behind the discovery of brand new planets.
Welcome back, everyone. We're returning with Dr. David Kipping, Assistant Professor of Astronomy at Columbia University, who's just given us the absolute wildest fictional planet to go searching for. Welcome back, David. We just established that your favorite fictional planet is Miller's Planet from Interstellar. Tell us what we know about Miller's Planet.
Well, it's kind of weird because of the time dilation aspect. I think that's what I got into. So in the movie, there's this planet that's orbiting a black hole. And they know there's some data transmitter or something they have to retrieve from the surface of this planet, mm-hmm. and they decide they have to go down there. But because it's orbiting a black hole, it's deep within the gravitational well, and so there's time dilation effects, and so it has a kind of bizarre situation where I think every 1.25 seconds that pass on the planet, a day passes, back on Earth. And so I love the score of this movie as well.
It's beautiful.
It's really, it's in Hans Zimmer, so it's always going to be incredible. And I think in the track, there's like a ticking sound, tick, tick, and that's the ticks are every 1.25 seconds. And so each one represents a day. And so when you're watching the scene, it's just, to me, it was really kind of impactful because you're thinking like, wow, every little tick there, you know, there's days and days gone by that you're missing with your children and your family and everyone back home. And so it just makes for a really extraordinary scene. I think the time dilation is maybe bumped up a little bit extreme. I don't know how, I think most time dilation effects around black holes would probably not be quite as extreme as this, but it's certainly an awesome premise. And then of course there's the oceans as well, but it sounds like you have thoughts about the time dilation.
Well, what I was going to say was, so Kip Thorne, who's an emeritus professor here at Caltech, wrote the original treatment for Interstellar. And as a very fun aside, the Caltech Astronomy Department got invited to a red carpet event when the movie came out because of Kip, which was very cool. So I think he tried very hard to get the math right. And of course, the visualization of Gargantua, the black hole that Miller's Planet is orbiting, is taken from real, you know, real physical simulations of black holes and what they would look like. I think he tried to get the math right, but I agree that perhaps it was pushed a little bit to make it more dramatic. I think I saw that, you know, in a rest frame of someone watching the black hole, the planet is orbiting like 1,000 times a second, if you could see it, but it's so close. So it's wild. You mentioned that it's a water world. So what we see in the movie are it's covered in an ocean, and we see these crazy waves, right? These tidal waves. And that's because the planet is so close to the black hole. So the most interesting way to think about it is that the tidal waves are standing waves. They're staying still, and the planet is spinning underneath them, which is just a very cool way to think about it. And, you know, obviously it's a plot point that in the movie that these waves are huge and dangerous. You know, the person, Miller, who originally landed on the planet, probably got killed by one of these waves. But it's a water world. And we have actually found planets that we think are consistent with a composition that would indicate like a deep water ocean covering the surface. So that's another like really cool aspect of Miller's Planet, that it's a water world.
Yeah, I love that, the spinning Earth thing. I mean, that's also true when you teach tides. I teach tides here at Columbia sometimes. And you know, it's true of Miller's world, but it's true of the Earth as well, that the oceans bulge out on either side. It's not as traumatic as on Miller's world, where the quote is, those aren't mountains, they're waves. It's like this huge tower of a tidal wave. Of course, we have very small tidal bulges, but it really is the same effect, and the Earth is spinning within that bulge. So it's a good teaching example to be like, hey, you guys have actually seen this in a less extreme version in a movie. So I love it when movies do a good job of the science, because it it provides a cultural framework to teach some of these more challenging ideas.
Yes, you know, using media to convey science ideas, I think is really important. And, you know, especially in the age of the internet where there's so much information out there and so much of it is wrong, you know, having any way to get ideas to people who aren't necessarily seeking out science knowledge, right? Like people didn't go to see Interstellar because they wanted to learn about time dilation, but they learned about time dilation. So we kind of snuck some science in there. So I love that aspect of it too. Okay, so I thought about going the Waterworld route for choosing this week's carbon copy from the NASA Exoplanet Archive for Miller's Planet. But because David was so excited about the time dilation aspect, which has to do with the proximity to a black hole, I've ended up choosing PSR B1257 plus 12C, also known as one of the very, very first exoplanets that was ever found, orbiting a pulsar. So a pulsar is a neutron star that's spinning incredibly rapidly, many thousands of times a second. And a neutron star is as close to a black hole as we've found a planet around so far. So stellar mass black holes happen when a large star dies. So a large star uses up all of its hydrogen and helium, goes supernova, and then the middle collapses to a black hole. If you're a medium-sized star, then you don't have enough mass to collapse all the way to a black hole, but you do still have a lot of mass. So you collapse to something called a neutron star, where basically your atoms have all just crushed together and all your protons and electrons have crushed together and you just have neutrons. And this is the classic imagery. You might've heard that like a teaspoonful of a neutron star weighs the same as Earth, something dramatic like that. So it's incredibly dense. So these planets that were found around pulsars were actually found completely by accident. And it's almost a kind of like frustrating story because people, and we mentioned Dave Latham, people had been looking for planets and looking for things orbiting stars for a while and thinking about them for hundreds of years. And then these two radio astronomers, they're off looking at a pulsar for other reasons. And they notice that the pulsar is kind of rapidly orbiting towards us and away from us and towards us and away from us. So David mentioned redshift. So this is a similar sort of concept. And they realized that the only reason that this pulsar would be doing this is if it was being orbited by planets that were pulling it gravitationally back and forth. And so in 1992, these two planets were announced, again, completely by accident, by radio astronomers, a completely different science project. And one of them is PSR B1257 plus 12C. I've chosen it because it's similar to Miller's planet in a few ways. One is that it's slightly larger than Earth. So one of the things they say about Miller's planet in the movie is that the surface gravity is 30% higher than Earth. So you can see in the movie, they're kind of struggling a bit, right? Like it's a bit harder to move than it should be, even given the water. So this planet C in the system, the second planet in the system, is about four times the mass of Earth's and about 60% the radius, which calculates out to about 50 to 60% higher surface gravity than Earth. So a little bit more than Miller's planet, but you know, it would be tough to move on this planet. And actually, planet C is close enough to the planet. It's got a pretty short period, only about 60 days, I think, that it is probably, even if it's not a water world, which we probably don't think it's a water world, it is probably oblate in this way that we've talked about, which is that it's so close, it's been stretched out. So instead of tides, it's still, you know, oblate in this way. So those are the ways that PSR B1257 plus 12C is like Miller's planet. It is not like Miller's planet in a lot of other ways. So for one thing, in the movie, Miller's planet is shown to be habitable in the sense that there's liquid water, right? Like, so, you know, you think the temperature is probably right for life if there's liquid water. Now, in real life, for this pulsar, the pulsar is about 30,000 Kelvin, which is about five or six times hotter than our sun. And this planet, planet C, is orbiting the star every 60 days. So in our solar system, Mercury is orbiting around every 88 days. So this planet is even closer to the pulsar than Mercury. And the pulsar is, you know, the sun turned up the extreme, 30,000 Kelvin. So this thing is not habitable. It is not the right temperature for liquid water at all. And of course, it's not actually orbiting a black hole. It's orbiting a neutron star. There is one candidate for a planet orbiting a black hole. It's an X-ray discovery in another galaxy, which is just a candidate, hasn't been confirmed, but it's kind of a really cool idea. And I'm hoping that, you know, as X-ray surveys get more sensitive and more all-sky coverage, that we might find more of these. But for now, this week's carbon copy of Miller's Planet is PSR B1257 plus 12C. I just wanted to say it one more time. Okay, David, back to you. So what's next? What are you looking for next? You talked about your JWST time, but what are you excited about that's coming up?
Yeah, I mean, that's definitely high on my agenda right now. We only just found that out yesterday, so we're still kind of ingesting the news. But yeah, we've I think one of the most exciting things is the all the other science you can do besides from the exomoon with these observations, not just for this target, but with JWST in general. It's a wonderful instrument for measuring all sorts of effects that have been invisible to us thus far, such as the ablateness, which I mentioned, and the obliquity angle. I think that's a whole new science case that we can do with these exoplanets.
This is the tilt of the planet's orbit to the star's orbit?
So how wide is the planet compared to a perfect sphere? Does it get sort of pushed into a football type shape? And also, is it tilted over a little bit like the Earth? The Earth's 23 degrees. And so we could potentially measure that for many of these exoplanets as well. So that's exciting. And then, you know, just looking, I always like looking for new stuff. You know, you probably know that about me, Jessie. Like I love the exomoons, but I love looking for rings, Trojans, anything that's kind of new and pushing the envelope. And that keeps me very excited in the field.
And then finally, last question for you. Is there a fictional planet, and for you, I'll say, or moon, that you'd really like to find?
Well, probably Pandora, right, is the canonical exomoon that we hold up. And whenever I've given science talks to schools and to public lectures and stuff, I always show a big, beautiful picture of Pandora. And I don't know about the unobtainium, but in the floating islands and stuff, but I think a habitable exomoon, it makes sense. They should be out there. And it would be a pretty incredible discovery to find them. I would love to find one of those one day.
That sounds very cool. Well, good luck with that search. It's time to answer a question from the audience. And we have been asked, David, are planetary systems in the galaxy usually aligned with the plane of the galaxy?
Yeah, good question. I remember thinking that question when I was first on my PhD as well, wondering about that. But it turns out that there's basically no real connection between them at all. They're just totally randomly distributed. So we'd call that an isotropic distribution. And the reason that happens is because essentially there are some weak gravitational influences, like a torque essentially, that might try and straighten a planetary system. But the gravitational tides are just really too weak to significantly influence these planets. They're much more disturbed by their close encounters with one another that tends to kind of like randomly scatter them around. And so, and their birth conditions, of course, as well, which will be a product of how they collapsed in their giant molecular cloud. And so that angular momentum is really high, and it's very difficult to completely remove that with these very subtle and gentle tides from the galaxy. And so we see that observation, like when you look at, when you do a transit survey, only, you know, for an Earth-like planet, only a tiny fraction, I think it's like 0.5% of all Earth-like orbits will have the right geometry to transit. If that wasn't true, if they were kind of fortuitously aligned, then
wouldn't that job be easier if everything was lined up?
It would be easier. They'd either all just be transiting or they all wouldn't. That'd be it. But obviously that's not the case. It's a small fraction. And so the statistics kind of bear out that this assumption is true.
Right. And for our solar system, we can see that too. So our solar system, the plane of our solar system, the sun and all of our eight planets is actually tilted with respect to the galaxy. And you know, if you ever get a chance to go out to a dark site and you get to see the Milky Way galaxy, it's beautiful and gorgeous, but it's not lined up with our, we call it our ecliptic plane, where all the planets are that the sun travels through. And I just, you know, as an observational astronomer, I just think that like makes life more interesting that things aren't all lined up. All right. Thank you, David, for joining us. And thank you, everybody, for listening. If you want more out of this world astronomy content, please join us for our next episode. Like and subscribe, Explore Exoplanets. You can follow us on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter. And you can send us your questions. We want to answer your questions, real or fictional planets. And we'll tackle them in an upcoming episode. Thank you, everybody. Bye.